Last week we started on a very important, I can't call it a chapter, a very important attitude that each one of us must have. That there should be a preeminence of Christ in our lives. That's a priority. Actually, last week I think we were hearing in church, also in Cornerstone, about how we must love God above all things. So it's a time that we as believers gave the rightful place that Jesus deserves in our lives. And that we prioritize our lives to give Him glory. The preeminence, which means the greatest eminence of Christ in our lives. It is from the book of Colossians chapter 1, 9 onwards. We finished verse 9 last week. We'll just touch upon verse 10. These words are which gives you life. Book of Colossians chapter 1, verse 10. It goes like this. That you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing Him, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. There are four things that the Lord is talking of here. That you may walk worthy. That has been the theme of the church this whole year. That a walk of righteousness. That cannot be overemphasized, because that is why God has chosen each one of us. Second, fully pleasing Him. That is the exact talk that Pastor Rajesh gave last time about how to please God. We can love Him, we can have faith in Him, but that's not enough. The fruit of the love and the faith is manifested in living a life pleasing to God. Again, that will result in a fruitfulness in every good work. And again, it will result in an increase in the knowledge of God. An increase, a greater revelation of Jesus. So walk worthy of the righteousness of God, that is in God, is very clearly because you and I have been called to walk righteously. When you read the word in the 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 21, it says, He who knew no sin, that is Jesus, who knew no sin, was made sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ, in Him. So Jesus, the very fact that you and I believe that He died for me at the cross at Calvary, gives us an obligation. I mean, obligation is the wrong word at all. After all, it's not the word. But it says, the only way you can compensate that work, finished work at the cross at Calvary, by which He gave His righteousness to us freely, is to use that righteousness and walk in righteousness and live in righteousness. Otherwise, the work at the cross at Calvary would result in a void of unfruitfulness. So if He gave us His life, that is, it is for our sins that He died, and He gave His life and His righteousness. So we need to. Again, a walk of righteousness is focused on giving glory to God. We know when you read the word in the book of John chapter 17 verse 4, Jesus Himself says, Father, I have completed the work that You have given Me, and I have glorified You in the earth. Today, my dear brothers and sisters, I want to tell you that you and I, who have been created for the glory of God, can give glory to God only if you and I are able to complete that work for which God has called us, chosen us, and has placed us in this earth. If God's words in one of Ephesians 1:4 says that He knew us in Christ even before the foundation of the world, that is, in His plan, according to His plan, there was a particular work that you and I need to do here for Him. That it is only when I complete that task that I am giving glory to God. It is not the amount of prayers that you pray, or the amount of church work that you do. That is all necessary. But it is the work that He has entrusted to you personally. He has gifted us personally. It is when you faithfully discharge that work that you are giving glory to God. Again, a walk of faithfulness. Righteous walk. Where is it? Word of God says in the book of Romans chapter 1 verse 17. That in it the righteousness of God is revealed. And the just live by faith. So a righteous walk is a walk of faith. A righteous walk is a walk based on God's word. So when you turn to the walk, first we're talking about a righteous walk. That is, that you may walk worthy of the calling of the Lord. Second is a walk fully pleasing to Him. Today we will just concentrate on that part. Because righteousness, walk, we have covered it so many times. A walk fully pleasing to God. You need to understand that God loved us so much to save us. We all know the word. If you ask someone what is the sum and substance of the scripture, he will tell you it is John 3:16. That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. If that is the reason why he has called us, then I want to tell you that if he has given us a life, a spiritual life, then you have to live a life which is pleasing to God. That is the only way, like I told you earlier, that you can reciprocate the love of Father, of the Father, by giving the Son as a propitiation for our sins, and was manifested at the cross at Calvary. So if you say that I want to just do something for the Lord, for which he has done, unworthy as I am, he died for me, what can I give back? My dear brothers and sisters, the only thing that you can give back is to live a life pleasing to God. That is the only thing. He's not looking for your material, nothing. He's just sort of waiting for you to live a life which is pleasing to him, so that the finished work at the cross at Calvary would be, in the eyes of God, worth it. Are you with me? Because it is his death that has justified us and sanctified us to become inheritors of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Book of Matthew chapter 3 verse 17 says, Jesus, you know the situation when John the Baptist baptized Jesus. The word of God says, heavens opened and the Holy Spirit appeared in the form of a dove. And there was a sound from heaven which says, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Are you with me? The Father was pleased with the Son. My dear brothers and sisters, if you and I say that we are co-heirs with Jesus, or we say that we are sons and daughters of God, then this is the same commendation that you and I should be able to hear from the mouth of God, that this is my beloved son, this is my beloved daughter in whom I am well pleased. You can please God only when you live a life pleasing to him. You can't please God. You know, many people, at least when you were in religion, you thought you could please God by saying a lot of prayers or giving some alms or doing some good things. These are things which God is not looking at all, looking for at all. He is just looking at you as a person who lives a life pleasing to God. Hallelujah. Book of Matthew 25:21. Again, we need to understand. There you need to understand what pleased the Father, what pleased God at that point of time when each one of us have to appear before the throne of God. He says, well done, good and faithful servant. My dear brothers and sisters, it very clearly says that you have been faithful in little things, and therefore I will entrust you greater things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. So what pleased God? What pleased God there? Your faithfulness. Are you with me? The reward given to that person in the book of Matthew chapter 25 verse 21 is he led a faithful life. My dear brother, I want to urge you that the only way that you can please God, or rather not, I can't say only, one of the ways that you can please God is to live a life faithful to him. Are you with me? Hallelujah. These are words which are going to give you life. Please receive it. Because I want to tell you something. There is only when you stand before the judgment throne of God, if you want to hear the words ringing in your ears, well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of the Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, you have to live a life in this earth pleasing to the Lord. Hallelujah. Philippians chapter 2 verse 9 to 11. We read it so many times. You see, God was so pleased with his son that he gave him a name which is above every name. And that name every knee shall bow, in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Why? It was pleasing that God, Jesus came, gave up his divinity. He came down onto the earth. He was born just like any one of us. And he suffered a cruel death for you and me, so that the will of the Father, that you and I should not perish but have eternal life, was fulfilled in the Son, Jesus Christ. Father was so pleased, are you with me, that he gave him a name which is above every name. So today, another way that you can please the God is to do the will of the Father. Are you with me, my dear and sisters? The will of the Father, maybe it is something which will take you through trials, tribulation, persecution, suffering. But Jesus, can you imagine how much Jesus suffered at the cross? Hallelujah. Even we know that when he was here on the earth, he was both the Son of Man and the Son of God. In the Garden of Gethsemane, for a moment, the nature of the Son of Man manifested. And he said, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Immediately, the nature of the Son of God came in. And he said, no, Father, not my will, but your will be done. So I want to tell you something, that one of the ways that you can please God is to live a life doing the will of the Father. Again, another way you can please God is Psalm 27 verse 4. This is something you need to understand. Pastor touched upon desire. I want to tell you something. Desire for the Lord is an emotion that comes from where? From where does the desire come? There's so many things. How do the heart comes all issues of life? One of the issues of life is that you have a desire. You have desire for various things. Are you with me? But you need to understand that a desire which is of supernatural or eternal consequences is a desire which, hallelujah, the psalmist who knew the Jesus, who knew the Lord, who experienced him, said in Psalm 27 verse 4. You must read it. One thing I have desired of the Lord. One thing. Say one thing. There is only one thing you need to desire, my dear brothers. If you have that Lord, a desire for the Lord, that is more than sufficient. It says, one thing I have desired of the Lord, that I will seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. This is what you need. So this desire to be in the presence of God. Are you with me? So one way you can please God is to have a desire to be where? In the presence of God. In the presence of God. Hallelujah. Like Psalm 23 verse 6 says, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. So this desire, it is not you have a desire to come into the presence of God on one day of the week, Sunday, maybe for a half an hour or an hour, or maybe if you are a born again church, maybe 3 hours, 4 hours. No. You must have a desire to be in the presence of God 24/7. This is a way. Because I will desire to be in the presence of a person I love, right? Right? So, if I love my Lord Jesus so much, I must have a great desire to be in his presence. So, I should be able to say, one thing, Lord, I desire to be in your presence. To see, hallelujah, you and to commune with you, Lord. Hallelujah. Again, you need to understand one thing. Many people think that it is that, you know, a way of pleasing God is by doing a lot of things. Especially if you are a religious-oriented man or woman. You feel that you do a lot of things by which you can please God. You go to church, you read your Bible, you do your personal prayer, all these things you must do. But one thing you need to understand, it is not the list of things that you do that pleases God. It is knowing very well that when you do that, you are slowly becoming a legalistic person. Are you with me? Maybe you are redeemed. You say you are born again. You have got out of the clutches of religion and all that. But still, if your relationship with the Lord is again based on that, please, I'm not advocating not to read the Bible. Please understand that. Is you say, my relationship with God is when I read the Bible every day, I pray to him every day, I go to church every day, I lift up my hands and say, hallelujah. You are becoming a different type of legalistic man. Are you with me? So you need to understand, then that what you're doing is arising out of an obligation and not out of love. God is pleased with the person who loves him. Are you with me? Hallelujah. That is why we heard, again it was talk. It's all, you know, this particular talk was supposed to come on today only. But we know, last week we heard all about this. God was so pleased with David, a murderer, an adulterer, because what? His heart was unto God. He is not looking at what you do. He's looking at who you are and what is your relationship with him. That is what pleases him. Because God says very clearly that I did not come to save the righteous, but I came to seek and to save the sinner. It is not your situation that he looks at. He looks at your heart. Whether you have a heart that is unto God. Actually, when you read the word in the book of Galatians, there are several verses. I just picked up a few of them. I want to just go through that. You know, things which when you read, you are able to appreciate the love of God. And when you appreciate the love of God, you are able to desire that God above all things. When you read Galatians 1:15, it says, I think we'll just go through that fast. Hallelujah. Because you need to understand, my dear brothers and sisters, we have to get out of this religiosity. We have to get out of these rules and rites and rituals and list of things that I do and I didn't do. Hallelujah. Because if you are going to do that and if you're going to base your salvation based on that, you're surely being cut off from grace. That is what the Word of God says very clearly. So the book of Galatians, if you turn with me to the Galatians chapter 1 verse 15, it says, "But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me through His grace, to reveal His Son in me," not to me, huh? Hello? You must read the word, correct words. There's a lot of difference between to me and in me. So, "to reveal His Son in me, that I might preach Him among the Gentiles, I did not immediately confer with flesh and blood." So, you must understand, it pleased God to separate, to bring Paul into this world. Separate me from my mother's womb is to when Paul is physically birthed from his mother's womb, right? So, when Paul was born, He had called him through grace to reveal Christ in Paul. Hello? Are you with me? Many people have revelation of Christ. But what God wants is a revelation of Christ in you. So when you are able to reveal that God in you, that pleases Him. Again, Galatians 2:20, we always read this. "That I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live with the faith of the Son of God, who gave Himself, who loved me so much that He gave Himself for me." So this is a total surrender of ourselves, where I am willing to be crucified with Christ. Christ bore that cross and took upon Himself the death because to obey the will of the Father. You and I have to be crucified with Christ. A person who's willing to surrender everything, like Paul in the book of Philippians chapter 3 says, "I consider everything rubbish for the excellence of the knowledge of my Lord Jesus Christ, and to gain Jesus Christ." So a surrender, a person who's willing to surrender everything, to possess Jesus, to have the faith of Jesus, and to say that it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. That attitude pleases God. Again, Galatians 3:11. "But that no one is justified by the law in the sight of God is evident, for the just live by faith." So I do not depend upon the religious requirements of the law, but I depend upon the grace. Because God's word very clearly says in the book of John chapter 1 verse 17, that the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. I opt for the grace and truth. I opt for Jesus to walk into my life. Came. It's a person who comes, right? Hello? A person comes. A tablet can't walk and come. Is given. A tablet on stone is given. But a person comes. So when you invite Jesus into your heart, that is something which really pleases God. Again, when you read Galatians 3:13 and 14, you know, "Cursed is a man who is hung on a tree. And Jesus was cursed for my sins." And then verse 14 says that the Gentiles might be inheritors of the promise to Abraham. When I know that, I say, unworthy as I am, my God has made me worthy. Are you with me? Worthy for every blessing that He had promised to Abraham. Again, Galatians 3:26 says, it says, "For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus." Can you imagine that? Is there a greater status than this? That you and I, daughters are not missed out. Because the General Clauses Act says masculine includes feminine. Okay? Hallelujah. So, when you read this, "For you are all sons of God through faith in Jesus Christ." So, Jesus is, the Father has given me that ability to become, not just, some people think the greatest blessing is to have a, you know, an advancement in your financial status, an advancement in your social status. Many people get into marriage alliances for social status. Are you with me? I mean, I'm just saying because it's all practical things. That is, I'm just giving an example only so that you may understand that they are of a low social status, but they are rich. There is the other people who are high social status, but they are not very rich. This is a situation which you can see. So the rich and the poor, low status and the high status get married. The low status rich man marries the high status poor man so that in riches there'll be a transfer, in status there'll be a transfer. Are you with me? This marriage alliance sometimes are like that. But I want to tell you, this is the greatest alliance that you and I can have that says, for you are all sons of God through faith in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So this makes, it should give me such great comfort that I am going to live a life pleasing to God. Hallelujah. He has raised me up. He has, this from your lowly position, he has raised you up. Again, Galatians 4, 6 and 7. It says, and because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then you are a heir of God through Christ. Making a heir of the kingdom. Oof, can you imagine? Heir of the kingdom of God. It's not heir of a kingdom like someone who married the British prince. She became a heir, indirectly a heir of the kingdom. Whatever they have, whatever little they have, they don't have much. Are you with me? But I want to tell you, you are a heir of the kingdom of God just because Jesus Christ died for you. Because of your faith in that finished work at the cross at Calvary, you can raise your situation, your status, not only in the heavenlies, but even in the earth, you can do that. Again, Galatians 4, 23, 26 says, but he who was of the bond woman was born according to the flesh, and he of the free woman through the promise, which things are symbolic. This is something which you and I mean, earlier we talked about Jerusalem worship, which is a true church. This is again another revelation of which is a true church. Again, it says, for these are the two covenants. Remember, it says God's word is unchanging. God's word is a truth. Because John 17, 17 says, my word is truth. It says, for these are the two covenants, the one from Mount Sinai, which gives birth to bondage, which is Hagar. For this Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia and corresponds to Jerusalem, which now is and is in bondage with her children. Are you with me? Jerusalem is in bondage. When you say Jerusalem is in bondage, it does not mean the political Jerusalem, but the spiritual Jerusalem. The spiritual Jerusalem are the people who are still worshipping in the first covenant. Are you with me? In the first covenant regime, are you with me? They are in bondage. What does it say again? For this Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia and corresponds to Jerusalem, which is now in bondage, which now is and is in bondage with her children. English you must read and understand as it is. When you say which now is, means what? Before it was not. Is it? Isn't it? Jerusalem is now in bondage. Means Jerusalem was not always in bondage, but it has now come under bondage. Are you with me? Why? Because Jesus Christ told the Samaritan woman in the book of John chapter 4 that it is no longer in Jerusalem that you will worship the Father, neither in the mountains, but you will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Hello, are you with me? Are you with me? Oof. And it continues to say, but the Jerusalem above is free, which is the mother of us all. The Jerusalem above, the spiritual Jerusalem, which Jesus established. Zion, Mount Zion. Are you with me? That is a free woman's. The other is Hagar, of the law. Are you with me? Of the flesh. The other is the son of the promise. So today, you need to understand, the worship has changed. Jerusalem, where the temple of God was established by Solomon, was not in bondage. Till the temple, the veil was torn and the presence of God came out. No longer was the presence of God in the temple. It came out into the hearts of the people. Because God's word says, do you not know that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit? And therefore, you should honor God in your body and in your spirit. So the moment Jesus Christ says, again, Ephesians 2:18 says, that we both, Jew and the Gentile, have now access to the Father by the one Spirit. So everything has changed. So the bondage has been changed. Because earlier the law was supreme. But people who are still under the law are under the bondage of the law. Hallelujah. Again, when you read Galatians 5:1. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Jesus has made us free, and do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. There is a bondage. Religion is bondage. Are you with me? The old covenant worship methods are bondage today. Because God, Jesus, came to establish a new order of worship under the priesthood of Melchizedek, who did not come from the tribe of Levi, but came from the tribe of Judah, the tribe from which Jesus came.